Hello, everyone. It's Anthony Reece. I'm going to get started here in a couple of minutes, and then I'll activate my video, and we'll get cranking, let a few more people log in. And looks like there's about 79 registered, which means probably about 25 will show up. You know how that goes. Anyways, it's free, right? That's why. So in a couple of minutes, we'll get started. So hang in there. And we'll get things rolling in just a few minutes. Talk to you soon. Hey, David. Hey, Philip. Welcome aboard. We're going to get started in just a couple of minutes. So hang tight. We'll get things rolling here in just a few. Hello, everybody. Welcome aboard. Thanks for attending my Wednesday webinar. I'm going to go ahead and let you know a couple things. It's no smoking, no drinking vodka during the webinar. Please keep your seats buckled at all times. Oh my God, can you believe what's going on with that Spirit Airlines? Holy Lord. Anyways, I'm excited about this webinar and about getting rolling here in just a minute. We got a few people logging in late. So we're going to give them a couple minutes to get in here and get rolling. Like many webinars on Zoom, but we got everybody muted and to keep things kind of quiet, hopefully in the recording. If you want to ask a question after I talk about whatever area topic we're in discussion with, just raise your hand by clicking on the chat / participants area, that button down there. And then you'll see the little raise your hand on the right there that says raise your hand or whatever. That's how you can go about raising your hand and asking a question when we open up the board, so to say. Things are going to be a little bit different. The plan is for me to screen share the paper we're working off of. So you'll be able to, that those of you, the 17 or so that are only patched in by phone, you won't be able to obviously visually see, but you'll be able to hear everything that's going on. those of you that are on a phone video-wise or a laptop or a PC Mac slash whatever, you'll be able to obviously see what's going on, and you'll be able to also interact by video if you want to. So let's go ahead and get things started here. It looks like we've got about five minutes after. So I'm going to go ahead and get cranking. We had about 79 sign up. There's always a couple dozen that don't show up. When I did that voices.com, we had about 870 people. And I think about 400 something showed up. So I find when I do these, about half of the people who sign up for one reason or another don't end up attending. So hopefully there'll be about 25 or 30 of us here. Today's topic is creating original character voices. And before I basically launch the paper and we get into it and talk about it a little bit, I want you to know that I'm not an expert in character voice work. However, that has been my specialty through my entire career. One of the areas that I started in back in the headbanging days in the 80s and radio was specializing in doing show drops and show prep and fake callers and stuff, character voices, David Lee Roth, and you name it, for DJs in the markets around the country. That created a bug in me that helped me evolve into animation, gaming, and the whole works, which I did pretty heavily for about 20 years or so. The last several years as a voice talent, I haven't necessarily been as aggressive voice-wise. Myself, I've been more active in the casting too. And I've been more active in the casting and helping talent develop demos, train, and kind of paying it forward, as we say in the business. And it's real rewarding from a standpoint of it's let me kind of feel like I'm the Uncle Anthony. I'm watching younger talent bloom into good talent. I'm watching younger talent slowly but surely make a name for themselves in the business. And it really what it comes down to is it's more rewarding from a standpoint of seeing and mentoring people these days. So I've dabbled in character voices my whole basically adult life, 35 plus years, you know, when I was about 10. But anyways, in all reality, that's what we're going to do today is we're going to explore how do you go about, what's the madness to the method of creating original character voices. Now, what I want to do is before we get to kill a little bit, a couple minutes of time here, I want to go ahead and screen share the demo section, for example, of my VO101 production area of my website. I've recently produced several dozen over the months, but I've recently produced this month alone a handful of different character demos. And I want to show you a few of those by screen sharing and letting you hear a couple good examples, a minute or two of each, of original created character voices. I help them develop them, I help them produce their content, and I help them put together, in most cases, the overall production value in the demo itself. A lot of the stuff that you'll hear with these couple clips are original from scratch production and or original from scratch characters. And the whole idea is not to take only the characters that you've been able to do, that clients have actually cast you for. It's to be able to show the prospects what you can potentially do character-wise if they were to let you explore and create characters for their pilot, their online webisode, their episode, their game, whatever they have. So I'm going to go ahead and screen share here. And those that are on the visual should be able to see this come up now. Now, what I want to do is, let me go back and do that again. Let's stop, go back and screen share. And let's pick that. That's the right one. And go back. Now, these are an example of a demo that I just built for Darren Roebuck, who attended last month's voices.com webinar, who is a great voice actor. And he wanted something unique because he had interest from Nick and a couple other people who wanted to hear some fresh content. And so we put together this as an example. Now, these are all, again, original character voices.
These sets are really detailed. They sure put a lot of thought into this place. Look at those stalactites. Now let's see. The restroom must be over here somewhere.
Take the chalice.
Wait, huh?
Take the chalice.
So simple! The square root of 767 is 756!
Oh, Professor. This is so hard. I'll never be as smart as you.
Save your superfluous suffering, my boy. I have something special up my sleeve.
You do?
Sure. I've been working on a secret recipe in my laboratory that will give you super smarts.
Really?
Here, drink this.
So as you can hear, we created some original voices, and a lot of those we ad-libbed. We purposely turn on the mic, record, roll tape, as you say. We ad-lib because sometimes not staging your actual character helps those characters sounding strange, but channel. It helps those characters come through, and you stand in front of the mic and improvise, and you would be surprised at some of the stuff that comes out of our voice. Here's a demo I did for Marsha Bennett a while back, and this is more of a storyline type of gaming demo.
In the world full of pint-sized superheroes, there's only one bubblegum crime fighter who ranks among the best! Me!
And that was a visual clip from the movie Pint-Sized Superheroes. And back to our pint-sized hosts, Chuck and Ashley.
Thank you, Vanna.
Okay, for $10,000, can anyone tell me what was the color of that superhero's tights?
Well, Chuck, let me see. I don't think they were cafe noir, and they definitely weren't charcoal. So I'm betting they're a public restroom on the highway toilet seat black.
Now here's an example real quick, and then we'll get into things. A demo I did, again, creating original characters with a voice talent named Pat Miranda.
We have the objective marked on your HUDs.
Roger that.
Keep your heads down and remember your training.
I'm sorry, sir. That's terribly unfortunate.
Worry not, madam. I'll take care of this dragon with the sword of infinite mediocrity.
Come on, Tony, we gotta get out in front of this thing. Get down there and get me a lead.
Now, the idea is simply, let me get away from that, to show you and tease up a little bit of what original characters can be once you develop the character. So we're gonna go into this process. And I'm going to put the paper by screen sharing. And again, for those of you that just joined us, in the chat button to the right, if you click on the chat button below and it spans out the chat window, there's an area in there that a link that's called Raise Your Hand. If at any time you want to ask any questions along the way, and I see the hand hopefully pop up, or we do here, then I will click on it and let you raise your hand or basically talk with me and ask a question. So let's go ahead and screen share the paper that we're working on today. And that is basically, I got to go in there. Can you get that, or should I do that? Let me go back to that. Let me go ahead and let Russ in there. Okay, we'll go back to screen sharing now, and we'll go into the share. Okay, so the first thing you want to remember, having given you an example of what animated voices sound like versus actual voices that are non-animated, there are two types of voiceovers that we do in character work. There is an animated voice, and there is a non-animated voice. I like to teach it from that point of view. Animated voices are character voices created to sound cartoony, over the top, SpongeBob, Scooby-Doo. I can go on down the list. You've heard them for yourself several dozen, if not by now. They're basically what John Lasseter told me once and Tiny at Pixar told me, they're good Saturday morning voices. Exactly right. They're that after school, Saturday morning, old school sound. The Bugs Bunnies, the Mel Blanc type stuff, whatever, the Bob Bergen doing Porky when he inherited that. They're more of an animated character voice than a actual spoken voice. A non-animated voice is an example of not being cartoony and of being basically a bully, being a coach, being Tom Hanks doing the instructor in Polar Express, being Billy Crystal in Monsters, Inc. You can go on down the line. Tim Allen, for example, as Buzz Lightyear. Woody, again, Tom Hanks. Those are actual situations where we cast slash they cast the voice actor based on the celebrity and or their own voice. They're hired like Dwayne Johnson, The Rock, et cetera, and the late, great Robin Williams because of their box office draw. At the end of the day, it's all about selling tickets. And so major films, major animated releases, typically cast for the main leads, they typically cast well-known voice talent who are non-animated sounding voices. So there's really a big difference. Animated voices are typically used in a lot of the series, like Cartoon Network and Nick and Disney and Foster's Home and animated series. We like to develop animated sounding characters that are fun, unique, South Park guys, for example, et cetera. When we're doing a feature film or a major animated release, typically everybody will cast, for the most part, a major actor or a major talent who fits the part. Back in the Jim Woods era when he used to do whatever it was, Hercules or whatever, he did the devil in that or whatever. You find over time, the more you've been around this business, there's a big difference between animated and non-animated. So with that said, we as character actors are going to develop our speaking voice, and we're going to do the part of a coach. We're going to do the part of a father. We're going to do the part of a bully. We're going to do the part of ourselves, the neighbor, just a straight old real world person. In animated type of voices, we're going to create, like you heard a few minutes ago, original from scratch characters. Those characters are basically going to be very animated in their overall sound, textures, and what have you. So what's the very first thing we do? Well, we know from looking at the script, the very first thing that we do when we look at the script is we do what? We read our part, the direction that's given. We talk about what the writer is looking for. We talk about what we're trying to accomplish, the goal, et cetera, for that particular role. Once we have a feeling of what they're looking for and his or her role in the game or the webisode or the animation or the project or even a toy or whatever, then we go to the next step, and that is finding the motivation for that particular character. How do we find the motivation behind the actual character we're looking for to develop? Well, those are all over the place. The motivation can be a neighbor, can be a friend, can be your uncle, can be your aunt, it can be your sister, it can be a guy or a girl at the subway when you're picking up lunch one day, it can be a teacher at your kid's school. Those quirks or those sounds or those unique sounds the individual has can be motivation in the back of our head for when we develop a character. For example, when I was a young guy, there was these two surfer dudes that were notorious in my neighborhood to be the Beach Boys. They were the Spicoli of the time. And they were basically the Wailing Brothers. And we knew in high school, if surf was up, they weren't in school. That's why. If they weren't in school, we knew the waves were up. And so one by one, we would all cut, go home and get our board and hit the beach. And the reality was, they were totally Spicolis before Spicoli ever became who he was. They were totally two unique burnout, smoking pot 24/7 back in the day, if you want to think of it, like if they were flower child hippie dudes, the parents were all about making love, man. You know, they were totally from that era. And one of them spoke really like, oh, well, what's up, man? Another one talked really low. Whoa, what's going on? And they were exactly the epitome of 30 years later, if you will, what the industry has evolved to be: burnout. And I adopted I ripped them off. And all these years, I've done ringtones, I've done cartoons, I've done all kinds of stuff using them. And the reality is they're the same voice. The only difference is the actual sound is lower versus high register. That's it. I just move them up the scale. They each have a little bit of a different quirk and a little bit of a different character trait. But what I'm getting at is my motivation was the Wayland Brothers. I met a guy years ago who is a Vegas lounge singer. I don't know if he is anymore or not, but he was totally a ripoff of all of the crooners. Tony Clifton, if you remember, what's his name, the comedian's alter ego. And all those guys rolled into one, and his name was Vinnie Vegas. And Vinnie Vegas was basically motivated by all of those sounds, me collectively putting them together. And he was real loud. He was like Guido, ultimate Guido, with the chest hair and the gold and the whole earth. And he talked like, yeah, baby, yeah. Hey, how you doing, Toots? He was real loud and obnoxious and in your face. And you, I wish I was you so I could make love to me, type of guy, you know? And the reality was he was basically motivated by all of the Guidos I grew up with when I was a young guy in South Florida. All of those Italian mafia type of Guidos, lounge guys that walks in there, yeah, start spreading the, I can hear Frankie in him, I can hear. And slowly but surely, he became very popular in ringtone world. Back in the mid to 2012, when ringtones were really taking off, I had hundreds, if not thousands a day, downloads of him. I made a fortune off that voice for a while until the ringtone world dried up. But Vinnie Vegas is an example of how do you find the motivation? I took one person's loudness. Everything he said was loud and obnoxious. I took a Frank Sinatra and I married him with a crooner. I married him with a mobster and I married him with multiple egos that I heard. And then he became, yeah, how's it going, baby? To where, yeah, how's it going, baby? He turned into being obnoxious. How did that motivation happen? He was in my head. And that was motivated by a bunch of people like the Whalens were. I had a Jewish friend of mine down in Florida, and I came up with his grandpa talk just like that cliche Jewish guy. You know, hey, Anthony, hello, hey. He talked just like it. I ripped him off when I was a teenager, and I used him all through my career for that ultimate epitome of the old Jewish guy. What if, hey? And so how did I come up with him? By going through their diner and hanging out with them and having literally lox and bagels and having breakfast with them on Saturdays. And he was always in the kitchen, you know, your soup's up, come in here. And I took him and I ran with him. He was my motivation for the old Jewish guy. Slowly but surely, you start to find motivation is everywhere. Now, what happens when you found the motivation and you found what you're trying to build? You look at what is my character to be's, because remember, he's just a little infant at this point, or she is. What is the backstory? What, as the paper says, what is the background that made the character who it is? What's his or her lifestyle, home life, the life experiences? Why did he become what he is? George Carlin, in the original Cars, if you remember, he was the hippie van, right? But he was a throwback to basically the Vietnam type of dude. He was that total burnout sounding, whoa, man. You know, George, I didn't do him really well, but that was the backstory of that character. If you're female and developing a mean, hard-ass boss, and she is just the ultimate BI, you know what? You're going to probably go back and think about, well, what made her like she is? What's her backstory? Why is she who she is? Why has she got a chip on her shoulder? How many men have, like Como, have sexually abused her and tried it over the years? How many, I got political there, sorry. How many people ultimately neglected her, took advantage of her, and made her an angry, bitter type of person? that's basically her backstory. He could be an old gangbanger criminal who's been reborn and is a Christian now, but he still has that street smarts wisdom. You bring his backstory to your character after you find the motivation for that character. The backstory is more important in character development than it is in anything else we do. In voiceovers for broadcasting and narrations and all, we know who our audience is, we know who we're targeting, we know what the product is, we know what we're trying to do as far as the sales end of what we're doing and why we're doing it. Is it an auto dealer? Is it a floral place or what? We change the sound and the attitude and the delivery based upon that. But in the character world, we have to basically make that character become alive. And they have to become why they are like they are. Look what Nancy Cartwright did with Bart Simpson, who she was originally not even supposed to, from what I've heard, do. She was supposed to rid for Lisa, but she ended up landing the role of Bart. And think about that character, a 10-year-old boy, a female doing, which majority of girls do, the boys, you know that. But think about his personality. Can you ever imagine if Nancy Cartwright didn't do Bart, how he would have turned out? Dan Castellino or whatever, doing Homer, you know.
Yeah, what are you talking about, boy?
The reality is, I can't even imagine Tom Kenny not doing SpongeBob, for example. That character would have never come to life if they hadn't put thought into what makes SpongeBob who he is, his laugh, everything. Those individual things that we're going to talk about as I speed up a bit are what makes that character, the motivation. Are they animated or not animated? What's their backstory? Why is he or she like they are? Why is that dude a hard-ass gunner, soldier boy? Why is that cat sly and cool and she's sexy and she's like, you know, hey, big one. She's the throwback to Mae West. Why? If you find the backstory, now you know, okay, I'm going to bring the character to life. And the next thing that we do is we talk about what's the attitude of that character. The creation of the character's personality, its emotion, its emotional state of mind. Is it mean? Is that character rude? Is that character funny? Think of every role of Joe Pesci's ever done, majority of them. Most of them are, he's like the neighborhood brat. You just want to kind of slap him. You know, how am I funny? Am I funny, huh? How am I funny? You know, I ought to F you up. You know, he's just got an attitude all the time to make up for his 5'2" frame or whatever his problem is. What's his reason? Well, somehow or another, from Goodfellas to Casino to, right? Every role he's really done, except for even a few, maybe in a Home Alone or whatever, he really has stuck to pretty much that same character. Same with Robert De Niro. De Niro has become De Niro in everything he does. Clint Eastwood, everything he does. But they know, they've identified their character. They've identified why the character is like it is, attitude-wise, based on its backstory that made it have that kind of attitude, its motivation behind it, and if it's animated or non-animated. Once you find that attitude and you really got it, okay, I got a pretty good attitude. This character is always going to be sarcastic. You know, everything he or she says has a sarcastic inflection. Everything he or she says has a little bit of a crazy, zany kind of laugh. Everything he or she says is kind of almost on the border of maybe being a little bit insane, you know? Yeah, we're going to go have fun, aren't we? Oh, my God. You know, whatever his or her motivation is, comes from backstory based on they now have that attitude they need to take that character and bring the character to life. And I call it channeling. You literally weird, can you hear the music? But I really see it like channeling. Some of the best voices, as Darren, who I let you hear a sample of, and has found out, and a couple other people this month that I've worked with on demos. Sometimes shutting off the booth lights, sitting in your booth on a stool, hitting record, and just going at it and making ad-libbing scenarios. Bunch of characters sitting at a bus station talking about Trump and Biden and whatever. A bunch of characters sitting in a soccer field talking about whatever, you know, whatever you can think of as a subject. You'd be surprised, kind of weird, how many times a character comes out and you go, where did that guy come from? Where did that girl come from? Then when you roll back and you listen 20 minutes later to 20 minutes of just these characters, it's like they're ghosts. They all of a sudden appear and you go, what the heck was I? Let me hear that again. And you've now found a new character. Now you go and you find out what's the motivation. What's the backstory? What's that character's attitude? Then what's the voice tone? You find creating the tone of the character's voice, the pitch. What's his overall texture? Is he or she is a kind of textury? Is a little bit of gravel in the voice? Or is she more like a smoker? What do you mean, Dolly? You know, that character everybody's heard a million times from Throw Mom Off the Train Order, who had a real raspy kind of Is the texture in the voice? Is there a nasalness in the voice where we go to that professor nasalism? We're talking through a nose. It's a cliche nasalness. Is that character teethy? Does that character, like the one in A Pet's Life or whatever, the little rabbit or whatever, or what was that thing? It was loose in the vents of the building. He had buck teeth. The third thing he said, a little toothpick, right? You can take a pen and you can put the pen in your mouth and say his line. And all of a sudden, it's hard for the rest of the city, all of a sudden. Those little props can help you create the texture, the character, the voice tone of that particular character. The flavor, the sound, what I call the sound pack, or the USP, the unique sound proposition, is how you develop it once you pick, is it animated, is it non-animated, what's the motivation, what's his backstory, what kind of an attitude does he or she have or it have if it's neutral, what's the voice tone and or the pitch, meaning what register, lower, is it an upper, is it squeaky, is it middle of the road, you know, hey, what are you talking about? Is he real low or is he, I know what you're talking about. Is he way up there? Is she like, oh, what are you talking about? Let me experiment with her. Yeah, what are you talking about? Let me, what are you talking about? If you move that voice around, the lower, the middle, the upper registers, the three registers, and for those of you that are trained with me, you know what I'm talking about. You can start to find the voice tone placement, the textures, the overall sound or unique sound of that character. Now you have its motivation, who motivated that, why, what's its backstory, what made it who it is, what's the attitude, mean, nice, sweet, warm, naive, what is the sweet, gullible, hard ass, what is it, the voice tone and the placement and the overall texturization of the voice leads you to, okay, I've semi-developed character, I've contacted the character, we're working together, I'm stepping back now. I'm letting my character take front stage now. I'm backing off a bit so that the character can evolve and come to life and develop its own character traits. Now, what special slogans or catchphrases, as it says on the paper, does the character use? Let's think of them. Don't have a cow, man, right? Bart Simpson. If I say these catchphrases, you know exactly who I'm talking about. Duh! Who's that? We all know who that is. Who's that? That's Curly. We all know that. If not, it's Curly from the Three Stooges. It's Soitly. It's Curly. It's Don't Have a Cow Man, like I said, Bart. If you go through all the different characters that are out there, a majority of those characters, you know, come on. The guy's made billions of dollars off that laugh. And how he does it, if you've ever seen it behind the scenes, is he literally takes his laugh and he hits his throat with his chop. Ah! And that causes that vibrato, that up, 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 up sound in the voice. And that's what he does. Patrick, his alter ego friend, is basically a dumb starfish. He's a dumb, dumb. Oh, he's a little bit unpolitically correct these days, but reality is, he's kind of a dumb, smart, dumb starfish. And the character was evolved from that backstory. Nobody knows really the motivation. He's definitely animated. He's definitely got an attitude of being a little bit not the sharpest tool in the shed. And his voice is a little bit more in the lower to lower middle range of the register. Now, once those characteristic traits are put together, you decide, I had a character, for example, that I did years ago, over in India, when Lebanon was still a country and some other countries. And it was part of a series that I was involved in. It only lasted 26 episodes, but it was fun for a few years. And there was a character that I did, and everything he said, his character trait that I created was like, before he talked, he would go, I don't know how that's going to happen. See, he would put that before everything. We call that while in the business, whatever, human sounds, whatever. The reality is, it's a characteristic trait that that character always had. For example, I had another character that I did. Every time he responded, hey, you want to get ice cream? Let me think about it. He put a in front of everything. Why? Because he becomes identifiable to that trait, that slogan, that catchphrase, that whatever. So you can see that once you develop the character and you've got an animated character and or he's not animated or she is, and you found his or her motivation based on whoever you think, it could be a local delivery, it could be your pizza guy that comes to your neighborhood whenever he drops up pizzas or she does. Once you find the backstory, why they become who they are, what's the attitude, what's the over voice tone, what's the pitch, what's the textures, what's the sound, is there an overbite, is there a lift, is there a nasalness, is he no teeth, does he talk like Clint Eastwood where he's got a little bit of, she has a little bit of a lockjaw, it's not being wine, you know, do you lock your teeth all the time? That creates that uniqueness about the character that's different than just a talking out loud character. There's something about that. Clint Eastwood made an entire career off of that. Go ahead, make my day. He's got that locked kind of thing going on. Well, do you punk? You know, when we exaggerate him, he's animated exaggeratedly. We lock our teeth. Same with Jack Nicholson, for example. Jack Nicholson's got that kind of sarcastic. Everything he says is, well, isn't that special? He's got that kind of just a sarcastic. You don't know if he's going to stab you or if he's going to pull out a bunch of flowers when he reaches for his pocket, right? That's who he is. That's his attitude. That's his, if you will, overall character traits. Now, once you've evolved the character traits, you want to go for what? Consistency. You want to become consistent. Once you establish the character, it must have a life of its own and remain consistent. If you are auditioning, and I can trust me on this, take this golden pop-up nugget. If you're auditioning and you put the time in and you invest the time, 15 minutes or whatever, into developing a character, and you send it off into never hear from that client prospect again land, still take that character and put it in your cast in the closet. Like, think of it as your own SNL cast. As you develop a character and you invest in it, keep it, own it, name it, and put it. Vinny Vegas, for me, for example. The Burnout Surfer Dudes that I had. Stully that I came up with. I can go on down the list of my characters. Dumb Dog. Slim and Lucky, the two hillbilly boys that I've done for Halloween animatronic places for years. You know, hi, I'm Slim. You know, he's just a dumb hill. Hi, I'm Slim. How y'all doing? He's just an animated scarecrow, but he's like a... The point I'm getting at is I named them. When I developed them, I never used them for at least a year. Eventually, somebody sold it because they heard my demo and said, we like that character. And the reality is they ultimately rear their ugly heads. So if you're investing in a character and you've done all the stuff we're talking about in 10, 15 minutes, and you've evolved that character and it's come to life, add it to your cast, like your SNL cast. Now you have a superhero, a villain, a queen or a king, a prince or princess, a Dracula or a Dracula countess, a dumb dog, sexy cat. You start slowly creating what I call a stable. You eventually create a cast that when the day comes, I even recommend to my talent to create a notepad and save it on your Mac or your PC or whatever, of literally notepad.txt. And every time you create a character, add it to the list, what that character is, and keep a sample of that character, a 10-second bite, in a folder on your hard drive called characters, original characters. And if you ever get a casting where they say, we're looking for a monster that sounds like Freddy Krueger. And you remember, didn't I do one of those last year for an audition I never heard about? You go into the folder, there's that clip, and you mimic that clip. I guarantee you it'll be like it was yesterday, because you put the investment of time into evolving, developing, creating an original character. I probably have, not to exaggerate, but some of you know me, I probably have easily 75 to 100, give or take, core characters. Yeah, I could have tons more, but unless that character is really unique and deserves me and my attention and deserves to be part of our cast, I keep it. If it's just another fly-by-night, and everybody does those, yeah, I throw them away. But the reality is, if I think that character is worthwhile, I keep it. The reason is that I want to own that character as much as I want that character to come to life now. I've decided if it's animated, non-animated. I found motivation. I've given a backstory. I know what that backstory is. I know that is why they have the attitude he or she has. I've added the voice textures, the tones, the placement, the flavor, the overall sound of that character. I've created a overall feel, and I have decided on the voice pace, which I skipped over. Voice pace and tempo is ultimately how fast the character is going to talk. Now, in a lot of cases, this is a very important note, your voice pace of your character is going to be dependent a lot of about how much time they're going to allot you in an 11-minute episode or in a 13 or a 26 or whatever minute episode, 22 or whatever it is. It may be a 7-minute pilot for a MIP or whatever. If your character is only allowed to have a certain number of minutes for X number of lines, you can't develop that character to talk through. Well, y'all, I'm so glad to speak to you. You got to shorten up what it says, right? So instead of saying, how are y'all doing? I'm so glad to see you. You may only see, so glad to see you, is all you're allowed to maybe fit into the time allotted. Therefore, when developing the voice part and the pace and the tempo, keep that in mind. When you're developing an original character voice, keep in mind the longer, the slower the character talks, the less the character can say. The faster it talks, the more content you can say, right? Think about that. How many characters do you know that can't talk a lot because their words are real slow? Like Igor from Winnie the Pooh. All right. He's real slow. So his actual dialogue, the script, if you will, is really limited of what he can say in the time allotted for his line. If that character is like a Joe Pesci type of character, really fast. What are you talking about? What are you, nuts? If he's really hyper, really excited all the time on caffeine overload, then you can probably fit a bunch of time, a content in the time. So the pace and the tempo is very important. Is it fast? Is it both? Is it slow? Is it deliberately slow, but Abbo pick up real fast sometimes? How are you going to move that character's dialogue? Very important, because when you send out an audition and the animator gets that, they're going to drop it into their animation bay potentially with several other characters and to see how that whole scene plays out, see how you work off one another, how the characters sound together. And if you're too slow, they're going to go, well, we like the voice, but we got to have that person speed up. So they're going to speed it up mechanically just to hear what it sounds like. Or they're going to potentially ask you for a recut / callback, or they're going to blow you off completely. I tell people, make sure that's part of the pre-discussion if you can. How fast do you hear the pace of this character? Well, the character has to be somewhat quick because he or she has limited time within each episode. There you go. So once you've got that voice down, the tempo down, the pace down, the motivation down, the backstory down, the attitude down, you've got a non-animated or an animated character, you've given it character traits, you've let it be consistent, you've written it down, you've added it to your main stable, it's part of you and your closet, a voice is screaming to be let out. Ultimately, you've got to be able to go back to that character. Meaning, if in 3 weeks or a month, that company finally replies and says, sorry, it took so long. The project I put on the back burner, we're now revisiting that project. We like the voice you did. If you didn't keep a sample of that, then you're going to have to look like you're not very sharp and say, well, can you do me a favor? Can you send me a sample of that? Now you're going to literally be taking that sample, which looks a little bit unprofessional. You don't have a copy of that laying around in your auditions folder. That client is going to then hope that you can match what you ad-libbed and created that thing. If you create an original character and can't replicate that character, it's the same as narrating a project. And in 6 months, they contact you and they want recuts because chapter 11, 17, 19, 28, and 29 have been edited by compliance. You have to be able to match the entire sound, the feel, the flow, the mic, everything. If not, it'll sound like patchwork when you send that narrative back, right? So you have to do the same thing. You have to be able to own consistently that character. I do the same characters I've done forever. If somebody calls me tomorrow and says, can you Slim and Lucky for us? I don't have to think about it. I go right to the, hi, I'm Slim. And I'm Lucky. Right away, I go right to him. I can go to Vinny Vegas. I can go to my superhero, which is a cliche superhero. Don't worry, lady, I'll save him. You know, right? Or his dumb brother. Don't worry, lady, I'll save him. All it is the same character, which we'll talk about in a minute here, with a dumbness attitude. Now, the evolution happens. The character must grow and become its own person. Early Homer. If you've listened to early clips of Homer that Dan did, when he first started early when they were on the Tracy Ullman show, and Itchy and Scratchy and The Simpsons were just a basic in-show segment. The early Homer was like, I'm going to strangle you, boy. He was really low. He had no really, he was like, kind of like, as he evolved and as Dan owned the character and as the character started getting traits and personality and his backstory and his attitude, and he's not the sharpest tool in the shed came forward and everything, he went from lower register to more of an upper to where now he's more in the area of like, you know, what are you talking about, boy? He's a little bit more upper, and I don't do him very well. I think always that guys that do a spot on impression, but he's more in the middle to a middle upper range now vocally. If you go to the YouTube, type in early Homer Simpson and you'll hear, and you'll go, oh my goodness, exactly. Whereas Marge, because Marge is not an animated character, she's a non-animated, she actually sounds like the lady, the actress that does the voice of her. She's never had to really change because she's always sounded like that now. Homer, she's just like the sisters, that she's got that sound that's never really changed a lot. Neither has Lisa. She hasn't changed hardly at all. Bart's changed a little bit, but again, not a bunch. Homer evolved because over time, he let that character come to life. Now, you're 15 minutes, 20 minutes into developing this. You've got the animated, non-animated, motivation, the backstory, the attitude, the voice tone, the placement, the textures, the character traits, the tempo, the pace. You've added it. You've got it consistently. Now you can replicate it. Today, you said it a couple hours from now, you said it again, still comes to life. I used to sit around, literally, when I was character developing a character at my dinner table, and my children would be like rolling their eyes. Will you shut up? Because I would sit around all during dinner, and everything they would ask me, I would answer in that character. And that helped me, over time, evolve that character. If that character is not allowed to speak, it never comes to life. You got to, over time, a day, two, sometimes three, if you can stretch it, depending on the deadline, let the character evolve. Lastly, once you've developed the character and you own that character and it's come to life and it sounds like it's ready to go and it is fully developed, you want to see if you can create an alter ego. Now, what do I mean by that? Like I said a minute ago, if you have, for example, my superhero guy, which is cliche, typical, I've used them on cities travel videos and PSAs and whatever. And he's like that real, like, yeah, don't worry, lady, I'll save you. You know, I'll get that cat. He's just got that real superhero-y kind of. I created for this webisodes that I used to do years ago called the Toilet Puck, I created basically his nemesis, which slash was his alter ego, his dumb brother, kind of like a Frankenstein that wasn't the sharpest superhero. He had a cape, he dressed just like my superhero, but he wasn't him. Superhero was like, that's right, I'm beautiful, ain't I? And his alter ego was like, that's right, I'm beautiful, ain't I? He mimicked him, said everything exactly how he said it, the same inflections, except he had a little bit of a dumbed down type of personality. You can do that with a Dracula. You know, ooh, I love to drink your blood. And make him more vicious. Ooh, I love to drink your blood. You know, you can play with him, and you can make one the nice cop, one the bad cop. One the nice Dracula, the next is the bad Dracula. You can take a countess and you can make her evil twin sister a little bit more, you know, mean and vicious and evil and a little bit more like you don't know if you trust her. I like her sister, but oh boy. You can find the alter ego. Now, what does that mean? It allows you to double everything. It allows you to create 20, 30, 40 voices and potential have 50, 60, 70 voices because every one of them is Lucky and Slim. All right, the Wailing Brothers, a superhero and his brother. I can go down the list of several of them that I've done over the years. Use the superhero. You can start to find that as you evolve that character and that character comes to life, now you can magically play with that character on your own time and explore how to develop a secondary overall sound to that character based upon everything we talked about. So to recap, and then I'm going to take away the screen share and see if anybody wants to talk about it, ask anything. Pick an animated, not animated voice. If it's animated, yeah, you can give it a lot more character, personality traits, et cetera. If it's not animated, you're kind of limited, but you can still go through this process and develop that bully coach or that hard-ass football coach or that female tennis coach or whatever you're working on. Once you develop it, find the motivation. Or once you decide on the animated, non-animated, find the motivation. Who do you know sounds a certain way? I'm telling you, the old Jewish guy in Miami in that diner that I used to go to breakfast at, you know, the Wailing Brothers, surfer dudes. Exactly. This lady I knew talked just like Fran, what's her name? But she was a real normal everyday. Hello, thank you for calling. She had a real just... She's exactly her. She's a great motivation for a character. I go to like American Furniture or a supermarket or whatever, and the girl at the checkout counter might have a really unique cartoony voice. Or he might be like, is that all you want today, dude? Right away I hear, oh my God, total burnout. I love it, right? Or he's like, how are you today, sir? He's like real, you know, and he's this young dude with a beard in his 20s, and you'd never expect that kind of, well, he's a motivation. Find the backstory, find their attitude, find their voice tone, find their texture. What is their overall sound pack? What is the tempo, the pace that fits that character based on the amount of dialogue potentially it has to read? What kind of traits or slogans? The stutter, the overbite, the whatever. Once you've got that, then the consistency is being able to replicate and say that on demand. Being able to, in 3 weeks, repeat that character to the client. Being able to longevity-wise own that character. Once it's evolved and you know it's pretty much at its, yep, I'm ready to go, see if you can create an alter ego. And that, my friends, in enough tangent, is how you develop original character voices. You can go for a straightforward voice that takes you 5 minutes to develop, and you can spend 20 minutes, a half hour, but it's worth the while. What separates you from the other castings is we know the casting guys, the animators, the voice directors, the people that are in the business, especially if we are a talent too. We know how much time you invested. We know if that's a cliche, that sounds like every other, you know, that I hear out there. We know if it's just a Morgan Freeman ripoff or if it's just a ripoff of a female actress that's already out there. We know, we can hear it. We can tell how much time you invested in doing it. Just like in broadcasting, narrative auditions, etc., voiceover, we know how long a talent put into written reading, or did they take the time and own the script. I can tell you in 20 seconds if you own the script or if you rip and printed, read it, and moved on to the next one, because you're a numbers type of auditioner. You're all about quality, not quantity, or quantity, not quality. Same thing when you're creating original characters. Even if these characters never see the light of day, it's worth the time to invest in them, create them, own them, add them to your staff and to your stable, I mean, and then keep every now and then, let them out of the closet to play. Every few months, I purposely will sit down, and when I was really heavily active, and I would sit down after all my staff went home. At the end of the day, the partners were gone. It was just me in the studio, and I'd sit in the booth, and I'd pull out my notepad, and I would literally look at that notepad, and I would literally be able to go through the list of all of those names. And just by looking at the character, I could take a minute and to say hi to that character. You know, the top of the list, you know, the dumb dog, the superhero, I can go down the list. And I would just rattle them off and let them come to life. Hey, how you doing, Anthony? Good to see you. How you been? I've been really good. You know, and I just go down this list and let them out and play once in a while. Let them out their closet and then put them back in there until you feel like you need to revisit them again. That helps you own them in longevity, and that helps you stay consistent, and that helps you stay in that character, if you will. Let that character come to life once in a while. So let me go ahead and kill this paper, and I want to go ahead now and see if anybody wants to raise their hand, and I'll be more than happy, as short and sweet as I can, to address any of those areas that you might recall. Let me go ahead and start with Nick. And go ahead, Nick, you should be able to now go for it.
Thank you very much, Anthony. Thank you very much for the entire webinar. It's been extremely informative. Do you usually request an image or a picture of the characters that you audition for?
Great point, man. You know, that's one of the things, especially if you get the ability to get an image that really helps you look at the characteristics and the traits and the overbite, the lisp. The character may have a really small body and a huge head because it's an alien or whatever. And you can make them, your mind, well, it's probably more of a brainiac type of character. So absolutely, when we can get a JPEG or an image or even a penciling, it's nice to have them. Reality is, if you go to like voices.com, voiceover3, yeah. And most of those places, they don't allow you to have, they don't supply you with a characterization, if you will. But in cases that you are blessed because they actually work with you direct, or they've contacted you direct, yeah, you always want to get one. You got to keep in mind, second thought on that is, aside from, yes, it's nice to be able to get an image so you can see, or a screenshot or a penciling or anything. If you don't, then you just do what you can based on the direction and the script and what it says, its dialogue, kind of the secrets in that, as I say, there's gold in their hills. If you look, the dialogue gives away a lot of that stuff. But there's also something to be said about allowing yourself the ability to remember. Sometimes they can even send you a video clip with a scratch track. A lot of times, if you're doing a dubbing or looping or dialogue replacement or whatever, you can actually ask for a link to an online clip, a clip at YouTube, or even, you know, a doc, Word docs area, whatever. And that way you can ignore the screen, the scratch check that's the front desk girl or guy or whatever. But it helps you be able to see the action, the interaction going on with them, even if it's a rough penciling sketch, if you will, of that scene. So absolutely a good question. You know, if you can, yeah, by all means, ask. If it's not, and it's not supplied, then you kind of got to go what we went through, look at the scripts and direction, hope that they can give you a little extra direction. And if you have the ability to correspond with them, because it's through an agency or direct connect, you want to definitely pick their brain a little bit. Don't become so much of a high maintenance talent right away to where you're writing them every other hour. you want to ask it all if you can at one and then kind of go for it. You don't want to send them 7 emails over the next day or two because they're going to see that times how many other guys are auditioning. So hopefully that helped you. I answer that for you. All right, let's see. Devin, go for it. All right, there you go. Hey, Devin. I think I should let you now unmute. Can't hear you yet. Let me see. No, we can't hear you. It's unmuted though, so you're okay. Let me see if I can click it again, see if it'll should trigger okay, an unmute. There we go. How you doing?
Okay. I'm just wondering what your view is on, we hear so much about how to create characters that really stand out. What makes you unique? What makes you unique? Is that, what's your view on that? Is it the character's point of view? Is it the actor's own personality they bring to the, is it their own humor? What is your view of how do you stand out from the billion of other people who can do voices?
I can give you this much, that half of those billion, half the billion, don't do near the time and investment that we just talked about. They rip and read stuff they do on 30 other things. They don't really put the time into creating an original character for that specific project. All of the items that we talked about, the personality, the backstory, the texture, the character traits, all that is what makes that character kind of unique. I know that when I do a casting, the characters that really pop, that stand out, I can tell because they added that, what we call, some people call a walla, that's that extra whatever, that extra stall in the voice, for example. You know, what do you think about this, guys? That little extra something in their dialogue makes it different than everybody who says, hey, what do you think of this, guys? Boy, am I happy to see you, versus, boy, am I happy to see you. No, the character allowed to evolve helps you as an actor allow that character to deliver its dialogue how it would naturally be delivered if the character hadn't come to life. So short and sweet, I'm tangent a bit, but that's what this process will help take care of. It'll help you stand out from that character creation crowd. Most of the people send in an audition, send in a character audition, and there's nothing special about it. Just like you said, there are that half a billion that are, then the other half a billion, which is not the case, 50 maybe. Then the other 50 go.
I'd be using hyperbole.
Yeah, literally. The other 50 are weeded out. And then the 50, 49, 45 that are left are, okay, those are maybes. What's unique about them? Okay, nothing there, nothing there, nothing there. I really like that one because I love the way that I had a character a long time ago that a guy did for me who would burp after everything he said. Don't ask how he did it, but he did it. Every time he would deliver a line, he would go like what's his name does. I hate to keep going back to them on The Simpsons, the bar guy, whatever. He always has that burp. And I used to laugh my ass off. And that was way back before The Simpsons really became popular. He was already doing that. That little something made him stand out. That little quirk, that little weirdness, that little, oh my God, you know, mm-hmm. a valley girl versus the, oh my God, I'm telling you that, versus the, oh my God, the way she pulls a word, the way you stretch your dialogue, the way you, what I call word whip your dialogue, you move it, you shotgun it, you allow yourself to machine gun words and stuff. All those characteristics, all those traits, all those uniquenesses, assure you're going to stand out. I don't care if you're doing voice work, if you're doing narratives, if you're doing an audiobook, if you're doing a character. If you do something different, the way you move it, like David knows, the way you move your dialogue, the way you move and stretch and pull words, that character, just like your voiceover, will jump off the page. So to summarize, when they're shooting their way down the casting queue, whether it's a pay-to-play site or just at an agency or a studio or whatever, when those guys are blasting through, they're going, delete, no, delete, yes, delete, no, keep, yeah, well, and before we know it, we're down to like the 20 that we like the best. The rest of them have been deleted. And the reason those are kept is because they were the closest to what we asked for. They paid attention to detail. The personality of the character was there. The acting was great. Got to remember, you're acting too. You knew how to make the line pop. And ultimately, when it came down to it, there was just something we call the X factor in the business. There was something unique about that voice, the ear, the beauty in the ear of the beholder. So I tangent a bit, but if you put all of these into the next four or five characters you develop, go to Uncle Anthony's thing there, watch it again. If you guys want it, you can email, like I say, at the end of it every time, and I'll send you the paper and you can print it out and look at it. And you'll find that if you allow yourself to evolve the next five characters based on this process, you're going to, you, trust me, they're going to stand out compared to all the other stuff you've done because they have that much more going into them. They have that much more refinement. It's like mowing your lawn, trimming and blowing your lawn and cleaning it. And yeah, it looks great. But the person who knows how to really edge your lawn, weed their gardens, you know, put down new chip every year, they put the time in, their yard's going to look so much sharper. I'm just going through this with the lawn guy. Their yard's going to look so much sharper than the everyday average do-it-yourself guy that does his yard because the extra effort was put in. So the same thing happens in this creating a character stuff. So hopefully that helped a little bit. Let's go for someone else. Let's see here. Looks like Pete. Right, Pete, it looks like you have your hand. Monica does. I'll get to you next, Monica. Let me go ahead and work with Pete for a second.
Yeah, can you hear me? Pete.
Yeah, how you doing, bud? Hey,
good, very good, thanks. And I'd like to also thank you for this webinar.
Of course.
It's always outstanding working with you, Anthony, really.
Well, thank you.
I don't know what else to say. You're probably the best voiceover teacher I've ever encountered. Well,
we're all in this, man, together. And so I've been in the trenches, so I know what you guys do every day and what it takes. So, you know.
It's quite apparent. Just to follow up on what Devin was saying, I had a coach some time ago who made a career, actually, out of identifying five different people in her life and then channeling those characteristics as an actress.
Right.
And what do you think about that for channeling a voice? That was a charged word that you used earlier.
Absolutely. It is a charged word. And it's kind of weird because it comes to that whole medium, if you believe in the spiritual world or not thing, but it is kind of exactly like you said. I stole the concept of channeling or allowing myself to find the motivation and the backstory from an actor when I was back in my early days, and I did stuff on Miami Vice back, now I'm talking how old I am. And back in the early 80s, mid 80s, when Miami Vice was exploding, I used to be in some of those. And the actor who I worked with as a coach at the time was the actor who played Tarzan. And ultimately, he really taught me a lot of this stuff in the Green Studios down there that I ended up running with through my career. I understood what he meant by finding motivation. Have you ever seen there's a commercial that Sprite did that was out a couple of years ago, and there's a bunch of African-American basketball guys that look like gangbangers and hood dudes, and they look rough. And the one is kind of a little bit of obviously a gay, and he kind of, they go, cut. He goes, excuse me, what's my motivation? And you never expected that voice to come out of this, what looked like a gangbanger thud. All right. That's a perfect example. He wanted to know what his motivation was. Well, that's what you're saying. There are a lot of actors and a lot of coaches that teach theater stuff, improv, and et cetera, who ask you, they give you a backstory. You're going to play the salesman who can't find a job, who hasn't told his wife that he's unemployed. He's 300 pounds, he's way overweight, and he just found out that he's got third stage or whatever, diabetes or whatever. All right. You have to take all that and find what motivates me now. Where do I find that? And like you said, it could be your neighbor, it could be your friend, it could be that person you were talking about, et cetera. So your point is exactly right. It doesn't matter if you're creating a character voice or if you're creating an actual voice that isn't as animated, or if you're creating a character for a film and you're on camera, or if you're creating a character because you're on camera and you're supposed to be this really nerdy guy for some Tide commercial. It's the same thing. You ultimately only are audible. The difference is not is the same. You're an actor, your voice is the same, everything is the same. The only difference is they're removing the visual, which makes it even harder for us voice actors because all we have is the verbal audible stimulation to get our acting. So that's why I always tell people, little pop-up ball thing, make sure that when you are doing character work, don't sit down. You know, stand up in front of your mic. Boom up your mic a little higher and stand up. Don't sit at a desktop mic trying to do characters. You want to be able to move around, express yourself. You want to be able to be animated. And if you ever watch anybody from Pixar to Disney to DreamWorks, you name it, if they show them, YouTube's full of them, if they have the behind the scenes video and they show the left and right of the character and of Rock, or you'll see them moving around.
Yeah.
Especially Robin Williams. He was notorious for being all over, you know. So yeah, you want to definitely throw the mechanical movement because that is going to allow your voice to be that much more lively and animated if you're acting out. So hopefully that gave you a little bit more insight into that.
Yeah, for sure. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. All right, let's see here. We got Monique who's been patiently waiting. Whoops, I think I just might have accidentally hit. Let's try it again. Monique, raise your hand again. I hit the wrong button here. All right, here we go. All right, ask to unmute, and then you should be able to go for it now.
There we go.
Sorry about
that. No, thank you so much. I missed the last one because I was partially listening, and then I had to leave, and didn't have Fido or what do you call it, Wi-Fi with me. So anyway, thank you. Devin actually asked the question that I was going to ask, so I wanted to throw a second one out there. When you go after you create a character to a character that you want to audition for, when you go to submit it, do you add sound effects? Do you add the music? Do you create a scene, a scenario in your audition?
Yeah, you know, that's kind of a catch. That's a good question for those listening. There was a day of where I would say, no, never watermark, never build the sound. What are you wasting your time? Because when that clip is sent to the animator or the graphics guy or the gamer or the woman who's creating the video or whatever the situation is, the content developer, they like to drop that narrative track into track 9 or 10 or whatever in their editor. And they like to hear their own music and sound effects and see it in action. If we put music or sound or whatever under it, then basically they have to silence all the tracks. And in the eyes of potential prospect, meaning the client that's sitting in the booth with them listening, that's kind of a turnoff because the client wants to hear what you sound like in the actual mix, right? I used to tell people never watermark. For that reason alone, you never watermark. But unfortunately, there are people around the world who will the sharks in them water, speaking of Shark Week, right? The reality is there are people out there that are looking to steal little clips for games and little this, and they will. Voices.com, Voice123, VO Planet, me and some others that are in the business have become a little bit more protective of the talent. And we pre-qualify. I've always worked directly with my customers. We pre-qualify the candidate so that not a bunch of dudes sitting in the dorm with smoking ganja can't laugh and think this is fun like they used to do years ago and cast voices at these freebie casting sites and waste people's time. Now, most of the stuff that David, Stephanie, and other people at Voices.com, they pre-qualify. So with that said, it's not as important to watermark anymore because you're really legitimately usually 9 out of 10 times sending to somebody less legit. But here's my other food for thought on that. There have been times, and David and others who have worked with me know what I'm talking about, where I've landed a job because if I looked at the client and they were obviously a advertising house that wasn't a production studio or they weren't a content creator, or it was said, Michelle, whatever real estate. And I knew they're probably not developed the content themselves. There are times where I would send a dry clip and then I would send a mixed clip so I could show off my ability to produce.
That's what I thought.
There are times of where you can potentially land a job because of that. Years ago, I worked with Florida Power and Light doing their characters, Sparky and Power Surges, for their public service announcer throughout the state. And these characters are developed targeting the children to stay away from power lines and not throw their shoes up there. And in the day, clackers were still around back in those days. That shows you how old that was. And they were in Juneau Beach, Florida. And instead of me going in, because we had to go to studios at the time, I had the advantage of working at a radio station where I had access to a really nice DAW editing facility with an Orban, and I could kick ass the producer then. And I went ahead and they sent an audition to my agent, and the agent sent me the audition from Orlando and said, we think that you're perfect for this. They're looking for several different characters. Well, instead of sending them in, short and sweet this, instead of sending them in one wave file on a CD mailed in the mail to them per character, I created an entire 7-minute scene. And I created a scene where you heard a bunch of characters that were in the audience mumbling to one another. You heard sounded like a Looney Tune and Gremlins type environment going on. And I had a guy walk up and go, grab your attention, please. And he hit the gavel and you heard a mic feedback. And he was, today we're looking for characters and we're casting for a new public service announcement. And I created a scenario where all these characters were going to audition live walking up to the microphone. And 2 days later, I got the job and I had it for
That's like two, 3 years.
So what I'm saying is, in some cases, going that extra mile, even in a radio commercial, I've had times where somebody is, when I used to do a lot of work at Voice123 and voices.com, I had a ad house who I knew who they were. And the reason I knew it was them is because I knew the name of the person. And I knew that they were looking for a 30-second ad to be made for an auto dealer that was pretty reputable at the time back east. So instead of just sending them my voice track, I produced the entire 30-second spot with all the effects on the voice, with everything. It was ready to go to air. Literally 4 or 5 days later, we got a call. They said they want to know where to pay me. They want to run the spot on the air. And it was $700 and something plus the production, so $1,500 for what could have been a $300 or $400 gig if I just did the voice track. But since it was fully produced, I landed the gig. Now, you don't want to do that all the time. There are instances where you kind of have to think about it. Yeah, this is a perfect candidate for that. So I'll send in my dry check and I'll add a little effects on the second. But the reality is 75% of the time, 8 out of 10 times, you probably want to just send a dry voice clip track. Because if you don't know who it is and it's anonymous and they're not sharing, and a lot of them don't, my clients don't like to, they want to remain anonymous. They hate for me to share the name because I hate to say it, the talents, which they should never do, we should never do, will call the client directly and say, yeah, I just want to make sure you got my, that's a no-no. You never follow up. You never call the client. That's like going around the back of, there's a reason they went to the casting service so they could remain anonymous. So you want to be careful of that, but there are pros and cons to that. Like I shared, majority of the time, to summarize, you don't want to add any effects or add any sound. You want to send a good quality dry track, edit it, maybe a little bit of extra threshold or compression or whatever, just to normalize it, make it sound a little bit more poppy so it pops a little more. Noise-free, hiss-free, of course. But they're going to more than likely, if they go down the list, like most I've seen do, they're going to go, no, yeah. Oh, I like her. Okay, maybe. No, maybe. And then when they're done, all that's left are the maybes. Then they download those maybes. And usually the next day, the client comes in the studio or they phone patch them or whatever, ISDN or whatever. And the client will patch them and they will drop you into the mix so the client can see and or hear, like I'm doing right now, the video with you in it. And I can tell you right now, some of my clients, Japan, for example, I've got a couple clients that are just nightmares. That we don't want to. And I'm like, well, okay, well, give me a chance to go to the next one. Come on,
you listen.
And that's right. They don't want any feedback. They no. I like her. Oh, we like her. Save her. And they want it. Bang, 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 bang. And they want, okay, gotta go. Send me those 7. And so literally, if you added effect, if you added sound, if you built a mix, and they were a production company like they are, they're going to immediately say no, just because who does he think he is? Who does he think he is? Trying to steal our client? So it can be a conflict of interest too. So you have to gauge it. It's very important that you ask that. You have to, in all forms of auditioning, you have to read into who this is potentially without, do your research. You don't have to call them. You don't want to inquire, but you can kind of play a little bit here and there and get a feel for what they're talking about, whatever, and then Google them. Sometimes the company will come up the internet and you can kind of, because they may have a teaser already available on YouTube of their new trailer or this or that. And you can kind of get a feel if you're dealing with a production house, or if nothing comes up, you're probably most part dealing with a mom and pop who may be able to, like you said, hire you to be the producer of their own whole message or whatever. So good question. I hope that feeds you guys a little bit of extra food for thought there.
Yes, thank you so much. Thank
you. No problem. All right, now let's see where we are left with. That was Monica. Kitty, put your hands down. Let's see if there's anybody else left here. Okay, great. Well, last chance. Anybody else want to ask any? I see Kitty put it back up. Okay, let's go for it. So let's go ahead up. Oh, who's that? Is that Monique again? I think I just screwed up. There, Kitty, did I turn you on, Kitty?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Sure can, sorry about that.
Did Monique have her hand raised already?
No, I just dealt with her, so we're good to go.
Okay, good. I wasn't sure if it was her or not, my bad. So first of all, I feel like a broken record right now, but Anthony, this information is so valuable and people charge hundreds of dollars. So I cannot tell you how grateful I am for this. I've been to so many webinars where, anyway. All right. So my question is two parts. I want to know if it's possible to schedule, and I know how busy you must be, but your website for me has been kind of challenging. I don't find it to be very user-friendly. So I've often like tried to submit and I get error messages or whatever. And then I'll call and leave you a message and I don't hear back. So again, I can only imagine how busy you are. And I'm assuming that's the reason for it. But is it possible to get like a little baby tutorial with you one day so that I can better understand how to submit?
Yes. Matter of fact, I'm sorry you're having that problem. I really have no problem usually with people, but I guess occasionally we have a glitch or something goes wrong.
Or I'm just not good at it.
No, it's probably the other one. If you send an email through at students@vo101.com.
Wait. Tell me again, sorry.
students@vo101.com. And then just put what you just said, and I'll make sure, they'll make sure, Jesse and them will make sure that I get it. And then I'll respond to you and we'll set up a time to get together and hold a consultation or whatever. You can also go to the website and there's a consultation area where you can actually request and or block a consultation with me if you want to talk about stuff in private. But absolutely send it through to students@vo101.com or go to the website at the top of the website. Mm-hmm. You'll see where it says miscellaneous. And then under that drop is there's technical, there's demo reviews, there's website reviews, there's a variety of stuff that I do for people all the time. So absolutely, I'm sorry you had such a problem with that.
No, thank you so much. I'm really grateful for that. I will definitely follow up.
No problem.
And then the other thing is, again, with the invaluable information, right? I thought I had this covered, but there are a few things I was in terms of creating the, building on the character, you start with whether or not they're animated or non-animated. And then you said a number of things that kind of got past me. So I got backstory, traits, slogans, the register, consistency, motivation, obviously. And then I think I lost you in terms of the other things. Do you recall any more that you
remember? I know them all, but let me tell you what I'll have you all do, because we can wrap up here with one more question or so. You can all send an email to that same email, student@via101.com. And just put in the email, I'd like a copy of the webinar paper. And we'll be more than happy to hit reply and attach a PDF so you have you can print out a copy of today's paper. That's handy to have laying around in your booth, stick it to your wall with a pin or something and use it, you know, as a guide. Once you kind of have done it a few times, you kind of become, you can instinctually remember it from recollection. But
right.
Like most of my students that do my power training and my intermediate training and stuff, every lesson we do not only gets recorded, so they have a video archive of it, but they get a paper and they get to keep that paper. And later, you can go back to that paper and you can remember all the things you want to try to do for that specific technique. But I would say, again, send student@via101.com an email. Ask for the paper, and we'll be more happy when you contact us as well to attach it and send you a copy of the paper. So, okay?
Excellent. Thank you so much.
Cool. No problem. Thank you. All right. So let's see here. Anybody else? I got room for one more, and then we'll pretty much at the end of the webinar. Any last thoughts? Looks like I got down the list here. And I don't see any foreigners either. So, all right, so we're good to go. I just want to tell everybody, thank you very much for being part of this webinar. I'm glad you found some of it worthwhile. Sponge what you can and weed out the rest. There's golden nuggets in there. I can draw quite a bit. The webinar episode will be back on the webinar area free, probably the next couple of days. So you can go watch it again on demand if you want to. It'll be in the free webinars archive up there in the freebies area. If you find that you have any questions for me, or again, you need that paper, you want that paper, again, student@via101.com. If any of you are considering, maybe I need time for me, and this is the sales pitch, big deal. If any of you are considering, maybe it's time to really step up to a different type of character demo, or a compilation demo, or a gaming only, or animation only, or and even a demo that is geared to non-animation, that is just a spoken dialogue demo. Whatever kind of demo you think you might want to get, I can definitely save you some money. And the reality is, my rates, the reason they are like they are, is they cover our time, my time, the time it takes to develop the demo with a little bit of room in there, obviously, to cover my time. But ultimately, the shelf life of demos are such that we can't invest and mortgage our home for one demo that we can never do again, but for a couple of years from now. And there's a lot of people in the industry, unfortunately, that are great producers, but I think that the prices don't allow the demo to be, if you will, disposable from a standpoint of the longevity of the demo. So when I develop demos, I develop them to be useful, but in 6 months to a year, allow the talent to potentially build another demo without having to mortgage your home again or empty their college funds. So go to there if you want to take a peek at the demos. If not, best of luck to everybody. I hope that you found some of this informative. And again, send it through to student@via101 if you want a copy of the paper, and look for the webinar to be on demand in a couple of days. But thanks again. Appreciate you being with me, and best of luck to everybody out there. Take care.